Good morning, everybody. Again, on behalf of Beyond Law CLC. So, Professor Balram Gupta has always been an inspiration for us when we were students in Punjab University. He has been connected with academics as well as professionally. He's presently the director of Chandigarh Judicial Academy Academics, and earlier he was director, National Judicial Academy, Bhopal. We are pleased to share that Professor Balram Gupta is acting more like a mentor for this group, Beyond Law CLC, because he has been participating in these webinars. He has been a speaker in these seminars. The participants, once they come to know that Professor Balram Gupta is on the board, it gives them the pleasure and they just want to hear him, because his academics, his research work is not only recognized in India, but also worldwide. Professor Balram Gupta's daughter, Dr. Shruti Bedi, Justice Singhvi, former judge of the Supreme Court of India, has also joined. Justice Singhvi does not require any introduction as such, because he has served the highest seat of the Supreme Court. His judgments, especially the 2G, the way he has dealt the constitutional aspects, labor laws, his judgments, each and every one is a treat for the legal knowledge as well as the law laid down in the same. Justice Singhvi, we were fortunate enough that he had also served in the Punjab Haryana High Court. The lawyers always felt that while appearing before his court and the judgments which subsequently came thereafter, it was also knowledgeable for him, because once you read that judgment, the knowledge which the lawyer had originally at the time of arguing the matter, the way it was, the judgment came out, it was always enriching the knowledge of the lawyer, not only of the lawyer who appeared before him, but also the other lawyers and professionals. His judgments are cited during the academics in different spheres. Welcome, Justice Singhvi and Professor.
Thank you, Vikas.
So the topic for today, as everybody knows, is understanding the preamble of Constitution. And once that topic was there, only two names came in our mind, that one who is an academician and a judge who has dealt so extensively on these affairs, and the participants, we were quite sure, would easily latch upon it and their knowledge would increase. Welcome to both of you. Professor Balram Gupta, welcome, and kindly say a few words.
Thank you, Vikas. Good morning, everyone. It's such a delight and joy to be participating on this platform with sharing with Honorable Mr. Justice G.S. Singhvi. Justice Singhvi is an epitome of humility wrapped in humanity. I had such an experience, a learning experience from the years 1994 till the year 2005 that Justice Singhvi was with us at the Punjab and Haryana High Court. It was an education. His courtroom was like the room of the Judicial Academy, learning all through as such. Sir, I'm so very happy to share this platform with you this morning.
Thank you, Dr. Gupta. I am honored.
Now, proceeding further, the Indian Constitution is an all-season constitution. And therefore, we have to examine today as to how do we understand the preamble, which has been able to carry forward the Indian Constitution for the last 7 decades as such. My purpose this morning is, particularly in the present situation through which we are passing, as to how the preamble would be meaningful, useful, and can really contribute towards a harmonious functioning of the system as such. To start with the certain basics of the preamble, a preamble is like the visiting card of the Constitution. Preamble is the introduction to the Constitution. And therefore, the preamble in a capsule gives us as to what the Constitution really contains, the nature of the Constitution. Two, there has been some controversy as to whether the preamble is part of the Constitution, as to whether it is open to be amended or not. This particular issue was settled in Keshavananda Bharati's judgment of the year 1973. It is part of the Constitution. And certainly, it can be amended as such. Now, the question is, the preamble contains the basics of the Constitution. And Keshavananda Bharati lays down that the basic structure cannot be altered or damaged as such. And therefore, in the process of amending the preamble, can the preamble be amended in the manner in which it would negatively affect the basics of the Constitution or not? The preamble came to be amended in the year 1976, through the medium of 42nd Amendment of the Constitution. This particular amendment came to be introduced in the Constitution during the period of the internal emergency as such. And therefore, I would first of all like to share as to why this amendment was required, what was something which was new introduced through this particular 42nd Amendment, and how that makes the preamble more living, wholesome as such. Now, this particular change, the preamble announces that our system is sovereign, democratic republic. That is as it was in the Constitution of the year 1950. Through this particular amendment, two expressions were introduced: socialist and secular. Now it reads sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic as such. This is one particular change which has been introduced. Second change, there are four basic elements in the preamble: justice, liberty, equality, and fraternity. In the clause dealing with fraternity, which read initially, fraternity assuring the dignity of the individual and the unity of the nation. The change that has been introduced, the word integrity has been added through this particular amendment, which means now this particular part of the preamble reads, fraternity assuring the dignity of the individual and unity and integrity of the nation as such. Now, having seen this particular amendment, the 42nd Amendment also introduced in the Constitution, Part 4A, which introduced this part relating to fundamental duties. In fact, till this particular amendment was introduced, there was nothing in the Constitution relating to the fundamental duties. The focus was on fundamental rights. Of course, the directive principles, which were, of course, right from the beginning of the Constitution as an integral part of the Constitution. Fundamental duties, to my mind, were required to be introduced, keeping in mind as to what limitations can be there on the rights which are incorporated in the Constitution, which did have the real focus in the preamble itself as such. Jurisprudentially, the rights and duties need to go hand in hand as such. Moreover, the very object and purpose of introducing the duties, to my mind, was to ensure as to what role the citizenry of the country, we talk of the we the people of India, equally we the people of India owe certain responsibilities, certain duties, and therefore they were required to be blended. And that, to my mind, became necessary to be introduced in the Constitution as such through the 42nd Amendment relating to that. This morning, my main focus, keeping in view the present situation, COVID-19, is particularly relating to the requirement of fraternity assuring the dignity of the individual and unity and integrity of the nation as such. Coming to the duties which have been introduced, through Article 51A, subclause C, it says to uphold and protect the sovereignty, unity, and integrity of India. Now, integrity word has been introduced through this amendment in the preamble also. So whereas the words or expressions, sovereign, unity, they remain earlier as well. But specifically, the expression integrity came to be introduced both in the preamble as also a part of a duty of the citizens of the country. Subclause E relates to promote harmony and the spirit of common brotherhood amongst all the people of India, transcending religious, linguistic, and regional or sectional diversities. Now, this particular requirement or a duty or a responsibility to promote harmony and the spirit of common brotherhood, fraternity in the preamble, and to promote harmony and the spirit of common brotherhood correlate so well as such. And therefore, in the present situation, my main focus is what is the role of the people which is required to be played. I'm conscious that the state has a role to play, positive, to go an extra mile as such to deal with this present situation. But the question is, it is not the state alone. We the people also owe certain responsibility, a duty. And it is in that particular context that we have to see that this duty which is being read into the preamble being the basic structure and the basic handicap that we have, that the duties as such, there is no specific provision making them justiciable before the courts. And therefore, what is the significance, practical utility of introducing these particular duties as such if they are not to be read into the rights or the responsibilities of the people as such? In the present situation, in a suo motu petition before the Bombay High Court relating to the conditions of the labor as such was considered, and the Honorable Court was absolutely conscious of the fact as to how this particular aspect can be the state to be directed, the conditions, the facilities, the requirements, basic as such, must be ensured by the state. Having said that, the Honorable Court specifically recorded at the same time, there is a duty to maintain peace, harmony, and the spirit of brotherhood. It is in this particular context that I am viewing the preamble, trying to understand the preamble, how the preamble can really help us in a situation of this kind. Equally, the Honorable Supreme Court, in a matter on April 6, and exercising the jurisdiction under Article 142 of the Constitution, specifically recorded, people also need to commit themselves to the performance of duties. It is being judicially recognized. And therefore, these duties are not mere on paper, merely contained in the Constitution. And when we refer to fraternity, the brotherhood as such, and when we really punctuate ourselves to the present situation, the police being attacked, the doctors being attacked, the health workers being attacked. The question is, this is clearly not in consonance with the harmony aspect, common brotherhood, fraternity, as such for that matter. And therefore, drawing strength from the preamble to mind, this is something which the people have to owe and recognize in this present context as such. See, kind of things happening certainly is a matter of concern. And therefore, the citizenry of the country have to rise to the occasion to ensure harmony, common brotherhood. Going over to another duty, to renounce practices derogatory to the dignity of women. Fraternity assuring the dignity of the individual, the preamble proclaims. And therefore, in that particular context, in the present situation, not only in India, it is something which is happening around the globe as such. Domestic violence is on the increase in that particular context. I'm trying to understand the preamble, that how the preamble can help us in this kind of a situation in which we are placed. And therefore, incidents which are derogatory to the dignity of women, and dignity of the human beings as such. Take the situation which came up before the Jammu and Kashmir High Court relating to domestic violence. Women being thrown out of the house at night, no place to go. And in that kind of a situation, how do we correlate the two in order to understand the preamble of the Constitution? Meaningful directions have been given by the Honorable Chief Justice, Justice Geeta Mittal, and that takes the entire situation to be comprehended in the present given situation as such. Or for that matter, this particular aspect, a patient, COVID patient or the coronavirus patient, if happens to die, even the funeral becomes a problem. Who would take the body? And people are not allowing even this much. Is this not really against the dignity as such, human dignity for that matter? And consequently, what I am looking at is that in such a situation, people of the country have to rise to the occasion. And the fundamental duty incorporated needs to be read as a limitation on the fundamental rights of the people, so that there is an amalgamation of the rights and duties effective enough for that matter. We go a step further. The duty to protect environment patients suffering from coronavirus as such. They move out of the hospitals. They go out of their houses as such. And what kind of situations have been encountered by the health workers, by the police in handling as such? And therefore, at present, we have an emergency like the medical emergency, the environmental emergency, equally the financial emergency also in that background. And therefore, in this particular context, we need to see that how we blend the preamble and read the fundamental duties in that particular context. The duty to develop scientific temper and humanism. Now, question is, yes, the mind gets agitated in situations which we are facing today, dealing with those situations. We need to keep a cool to deal with the situation. And if we do not do that, again, we would be stepping out. Harmony would not be there. And many other things would flow in that particular context. Similarly, destroying the property and the duty to abjure violence as such. All these duties have a specific context to a mind. And I'm trying to understand that we can certainly read the preamble in this particular context, correlate them with fundamental duties, and read them as limitations, so that it's a happy, it's a healthy blending, so that the people are in a position to play their role as such. I'm conscious of the situation of the workers, of the labor, of the migrants as such. The Constitution, the preamble, the first promise of the preamble is justice. And in the threefold justice, economic justice has a prominence in that particular context. I'm absolutely conscious of this. Now, people are suffering, suffering badly. There is no doubt about that. People besides the state is trying to render a contributory hand also to the extent it has been possible. And yet the suffering is tremendous in this particular context. We have to see that this promise given in the preamble to do justice, particularly economic justice in this given situation, how can we really rise to the situation? Yes, there are limitations, and yet we have to move forward and ensure the minimum requirements as such, the needs as such. And consequently, it is here again that we have to see and understand the preamble, how more effectively the state can deal with the situation, and also how the people, the well-to-do people who are in a position to contribute, can also help in this entire particular process as such. Consequently, my understanding of the preamble in the backdrop of the present situation is that the preamble has to be having an interplay, healthy interplay with the duties which were introduced by the same amendment to the Constitution, so that we could look forward and see how we can come out of the present situation as such. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. We have all been enriched by your inputs. It shows the vast knowledge which you have. I request Honorable Mr. Justice Singhvi. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Vikas and Amar, for giving me this opportunity to be at Chandigarh through computer. Dr. Gupta is a great scholar, which I am not. I joined law in 1968 as a student, completed in 1971. And after 40 years or 50 years, I think that I still continue to be a student of law. And this is how I intend to interact with you. But before I start, some of the faces on the computer I know, for example, Raman B. Garg is there, Anu Chatrath is there. Some are new. In fact, I am new for them. Therefore, treat me as a student of law. I have, in my conversation, there will be few questions to all of you. First will be, how many of you are aware that about the population of this country in 1947 at the time of independence? I would share with you, it was 28 crores. In 1975, when internal emergency was declared, it was 74 crores. If these are figures are approximate, there could be some error here and there. And as in 2020, we are touching 140 crores. When we adopted the Constitution in 1949 and ultimately implemented on 26th of January, those who are in the law offices, my dear friends, please take out the Constitution. And all of you have read the Constitution, because without that you could not have got the degree of law. Read the opening 6 lines. The rest will come afterwards. All those who were alive at that time, all those who joined the law courses, and as a student of the constitutional law or the Constitution of India, each one of us take an oath. It begins, please read, because if you can read it, take out the Constitution at least.
I got it.
Please read it for the benefit of all, including myself.
I will ask someone to share the screen. That becomes easy.
Okay, fine.
Ma'am, can you ask someone to share that on the screen? I can read otherwise. Preamble, you are saying?
Yes.
So we, the people of India, having solemnly resolved to constitute India into a sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic, and to secure to all the citizens justice, social, economic, and political liberty of thought, expression.
Wait for a minute, Vikas.
Yes.
We, the people of India, you are included in that. I am included in that. Dr. Gupta is included in that. Amar Vivek is included, Raman is included, Mr. Amit Parashar is included. We made a declaration to be sovereign democratic republic, socialist and secular, as Dr. Gupta pointed out, was brought out in 1977 by 42nd Amendment. But we not only made a declaration, but we took a constitutional oath to secure to all its citizens what first thing was justice. And Dr. Gupta laid emphasis on economics. Economics will come later on. First was social, then economic, and then political. The framers of the constitution were ordinary, very wise people, not intelligent like us, but they were wise people having vast experience of having fought the freedom struggle. That is why they deliberately used the word social as the first word with the justice. Why justice was placed at number one? Because the framers, those who constituted the Constituent Assembly and the drafting committee, knew that wild and pervasive injustice is being perpetrated not only by foreigners, the Britishers, but people within our country. And unfortunately, after 70 years, we still continue to do injustice to large segment of the society. Perhaps few of us take care of going through the statistics. In 2012, the Government of India published a study.
Sorry to bother you. Komal Bawa has shared it on the screen and for the intimation of every participant.
Okay, fine. 22% people were below poverty line in 2012. As on today, according to Dr. Rangarajan committee, 38.2%, that is 4.54 million people live below poverty line. What is the meaning of justice for them? What is the meaning of justice, social justice for them? What is the meaning of economic justice for them? Political, leave apart the politics. Have you ever thought of it? Not as lawyers, but as enlightened citizens of this great nation. You must have been watching one or the other news channel, because you, all of us are free these days. I also used to watch, but 3 days back I stopped watching news. There was a mass of people who had started from Mumbai for going to their villages in UP. An equal mass of people had started from Bangalore for going to Jharkhand. You can't imagine the amount of injustice inflicted on them. This we are talking in the context of preamble, because we decided to ensure to all its citizens justice, social, economic and political. As far as Mumbai is concerned, no transport was made available to them. From Karnataka, the central government, the railways made arrangement for trains. The great chief minister of that state ensured that the trains, 3 trains do not move. And the people took on foot. Somebody for walking to 1,000 kilometers, somebody for walking for 2,000 kilometers. When a TV journalist asked an old man, "Well, you are going to Jharkhand, will you be able to reach?" He said that whether I reach or not, I would like to die as a free man. This is the state of affairs in which we are discussing preamble of the constitution. And dear friends, you, after justice came liberty, then equality, and then fraternity and assuring dignity of individual. After this, program is over, please spend half an hour. In last 70 years, have we been able to respect the dignity of individuals? Dr. Gupta talked about the doctors, policemen, etc. What about the female? A lady, pregnant lady of 7 months, was walking a distance of 1,000 kilometers, and there must be lakhs of such people who must be walking. A 3-year-old child, a 50-year-old man carrying a young boy over his shoulders. This is the idea of social justice. This is the idea of economic justice in 2020, on which you must answer, I must answer. And friends, there was no need for part 4A of the Constitution. No need. Because the preamble itself said, and to secure to all its citizens justice, liberty, equality of opportunity and status. At least as a lawyer, as a law student, as a lawyer, as a judge, and post-retire as a citizen of this country, I am convinced that we have done nothing except inflicting injustice, except inflicting indignity on our brethren in the society. Most of you youngsters must not have seen that time. Dr. Gupta must have seen that time. Scavengers. Even today, while in Supreme Court I was dealing with a case from Delhi, people are forced to go in the sewer lines for cleaning them without protective gear, and they die. Old days, the generations carried the filth on their head. That was the dignity of the individuals after independence. Pre-British era, forget about that. Maharaj and Madadipatis, forget about them. But this was independent India. And friends, read part 4, part 3 of the Constitution before you read part 3. Article 14, Article 15 and Article 16. 14 is a genus. 15 and 16 are species. Because read them. 15.2.
Right, sir.
Language of 16.2 is almost identical.
Meanwhile, Mr. Bava, could you share it on the screen also for the benefit of the people?
All our lawyers, I think, they all know about it.
Sir, they know it. But sometimes they say practice. Practice and practice only. Few people are showing it on the screen, but be that as it may. 15.2 says, no citizen shall, on grounds only of religion, race, caste, sex, place of birth, or any of them, be subject to any disability, liability, restriction, or conditions with regard to access to shops, public restaurants, hotels, and place of public entertainment, or the use of wells, tanks, bathing ghats, roads, and places of public resort maintained wholly or partly out of state funds or dedicated to the use of the general public. And 3, I can read, nothing in this article shall prevent the state from making any special provision for women and children.
Right. Now, when the Constitution framers said that there should be no discrimination on the ground of sex, caste, race, religion, place of birth, they also added Schedule 3, which contains oath to be taken by members of the legislature, members of judiciary. Of course, I leave unto themselves, all of them, whether they have abided by the oath of the Constitution. In last 10 years, 20 years, I have seen the politician talking about religion. caste, color, creed, race, and religion. Where has the constitution gone? Where is the preamble gone? And read articles from part 4. Dr. Gupta said directive principles of state policy. I, as a student of law, always thought directive principles of state policy are more sacrosanct than fundamental rights enshrined in part 3 of the constitution. They are for individuals. Part 4 is for the society. Read as and when you get time from Article 38 to Article 51. Each begin with the word the state shall. The state shall. The state shall. And ponder over, have in 70 years the state been able to fulfill its tasks as a welfare state? Of course, I have no doubt about, in my mind, about my own thinking that the state has miserably failed. Miserably failed right from 1950. Dear friends, ponder over, think. Today, of course, access to education has increased. The number of people who are going to schools has increased. What the first task of the political government and the bureaucracy would have been? To ensure compulsory education for each and every human being living in this country. At least compulsory education, free education up to class 10. That was the primary task of a welfare state, which it failed. We were more concerned, of course, necessity. We were more concerned with dams, Bharat Heavy Electricals, HAL, Durgapura Steel Plant. They were necessary, no doubt. But more important was education. More important was compulsory health. What we have done to our citizenry today? How can we take whether, well, judges including? You must have seen a month ago, not even a month ago, 15-20 days ago, a petition was filed in the Supreme Court about an insulting class, insulted class of citizenry of this country who are called migrant labor. Somebody filed a petition that please hear their grievance. Our great Supreme Court said that the matter will be heard after 10 days. As if the Supreme Court had ensured a guarantee at least for 10 days those people will live. They had a talk with the Almighty God. And God had given an assurance that for 10 days nothing will happen. I do not want to mention of it at the same time. Another petition taken up within 14 hours of its being filed in the night at 8-7. They are also judges taking oath and schedule 3 of the constitution. Oath to the constitution. I will abide by the constitution. We will maintain the integrity of the nation. This is how we behave. Therefore, it is high time for, when you are free nowadays, please, my advice is, my request is, read 2 things. Make a note of it. One is a book by an author called MacIver, M-A-C-I-Y-E-R, MacIver. It is a 1936 edition. Theory of Modern State. That was what was written in 1936. Or what our poets in 1950 wrote, Dekh tere sansar ki halat kya ho gayi bhagwan, kitna badal gaya insaan. that Kavi Pradeep, MacIver thought in 1936. And when you are having time, please take out 5 volumes of Framing of Constitution by B. Shiva Rao. It will be available in the library of the court. It will be available in the library of the Punjab University. It will be available in the Judicial Academy. Take permission from Dr. Gupta. He will readily make them available. Read how the Constitution was made. And then you will be able to appreciate what are your duties as citizens of India.
Sorry to bother. Could you repeat that 5 volumes? Because the internet was unstable for a minute.
B. Framing of Constitution by B. Shiva Rao. Of course, I have another side remark. In some of the judgments, papers which are printed in this book have been cited by the judges as if they are writing on their own, without recognizing the face of the person who had written that article or that paper before the framing of the Constitution. That is, of course, a degree of honesty on our part. Read these 2 books, you will feel enlightened. Mahatma Gandhi, even before independence, was of the view that we must, of course, he was talking about Congress party be disbanded. If that had been done, it would have been a different story together today. He also said that panchayats should be made units of self-governance. It fell upon the then Prime Minister, Mr. Rajiv Gandhi, to initiate and ultimately bring part 9 and part 9A in the Constitution. Panchayats and municipalities should be units of self-governance. Unfortunately, all these years, we have miserably failed in making the panchayats as units of self-government. And that is why the poor people from villages, UP, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Haryana, Punjab, go to Mumbai, go to Karnataka, come to Delhi, and ultimately live in slums. You must be wondering why this coronavirus is spreading in place like Dharavi in Mumbai. Everybody talks about Dharavi. But you do not know, Chandigarh people will perhaps not know except Sector 25, that in every city of this country there is a Dharavi. In a 50-yard plot, there is a small tenement of 4-story, 40 people living. One unit on each floor, 10 people living. And as you must be every day listening that advertisement on the mobile, wash your hands, use sanitizers, use mask. I laugh at myself. Please don't ask those people. Where from? We have not been able to provide 2 meals to 454 million people after 70 years of coming into force of the Constitution. And we, of course, lawyers, judges, students of law, of course, the political class as such, talk about Constitution. Talk about urban elite. Well, I would request you study these 2. One is the 5 sets of B. Shiva Rao and one is MacIver of the Modern State. The reference to, honest reference to MacIver has been made by Justice K.K. Matthew in Para 80. of the judgment in Sukhdev Singh versus Bhagat Ram, 1975 Supreme Court. He was one judge. I always revel, he was absolutely honest to the core in each of his judgment. He always recognized from where he is citing the particular author. Others have not been that honest. Let's talk about them. But what can you and I do? Because Dr. Gupta wanted, what should we do today? I have a very simple solution. Simple solution, not as a judge, not as a lawyer, not as a student of law, but a ordinary citizen. I want to share one story, not a story, it is not a myth, it's a reality. I was a child of 5 to 7 years, was born in Jodhpur, had a large house, belonged to affluent family at that time. A haveli I was living. When it was purchased in 1935, my great grandmother asked my grandfather that you should earmark one place for puja, katha, etc. And you will be surprised, one gentleman who was selling Tirayana used to come every day to read some scriptures, Mahabharat, Ramayana, Puran, and Gita, 15-20 minutes. During discourse, in order to make it interesting, he used to narrate stories. And on one day, he asked the gathering of 150 people one question, which question I am going to ask to you also. If your income is rupee 1 today, of course 1 has become irrelevant today. It doesn't carry any value. Because the minimum of the people living below poverty line, their everyday earning is 123 rupees. Not even 1/4 of a brick of ice cream would be bought in 123 rupees. Or maybe half of the brick will be. So he asked, if your income is rupees 1, how would you distribute it? People could not answer. He answered it. 1/4 I will spend for today. 1/4 I will deposit for tomorrow. 1/4 I will spend it for yesterday. And 1/4 I will throw in the well. We were kids, 5-7 years, my co-brothers, 3-4 of us. On one day we gathered courage and went to ask him, what is the meaning of this 1/4 distribution of rupee 1? Then he said in his own Marwari language, I am only translating in English or Hindi, he said 1/4 spend it for today means your daily needs. Your food, your clothes, of your family. 1/4 you reserve for your children, their education. At that time, men thought 1/4 for education, their marriage, etc., and settlement of the life, in the life. 1/4 you spend for your parents, your grandparents, and elders in the family. But the last query still was, why throw 1/4 in the well? He said that 1/4 does not belong to you. That belongs to the society. All youngsters should, after this program is over, open their computers or mobile. Go to a movie of Nana Patekar. First movie was Ankush. And in that there is a Prarthana. Second stanza of the Prarthana is, we haven't brought anything, it doesn't belong anything to me, and I should not think that what I have got from the world. I should think, what can I give back? Dear friends, all of you, including myself, are capable of parting with something which the world has given to us. And I have no doubt in my mind that if all of you decide today, whatever has happened in the past has happened, you can't retrieve it back. If you decide today, that will be your great contribution. Give back to the society. educate one child who can't afford education, minimum education. Take an oath unto yourself, within yourself, that I will spend money, a part of my income, for providing finances to one child, male or female, so that they can get education. It's an absolute illusion that the state will provide free education. You can provide it. You will give it back because it doesn't belong to you. That's your great contribution. One does not know if 20 crore people in India decide today that each one of us will contribute for the education of a child every year. I don't know whether I will remain alive, Dr. Gupta will remain alive, or all of you will remain alive, but surely if 20 crore children get education, they will not have to walk 1,000 kilometers. Second thing, which is equally important, which we have unfortunately, our entire generations are responsible for damaging the ecology and environment. Luckily, in our country, we are able to talk about natural resources, protection to environment, and the Supreme Court has been in the forefront. In fact, none of you are aware of a judgment of Punjab High Court in 1964. Delivered by Justice I.D. Dua in the case of Mr. D.S. Nehra, open 1964, AIR 1964, Punjab, as and when you get time, you read Durga Shankar, perhaps D.S. Nehra's name is Durga Shankar Nehra. It is with his title that the case is there. A petrol pump was thought to be established in a residential colony on a plot which was meant for public use. And I am glad that I worked in that high court where the first judgment in public interest litigation was given in the country. It is not M.C. Mehta judgment from the Supreme Court. It is the Punjab judgment which is the first judgment. In all the after independence, we have destroyed ecology and environment like anything. You have to do not great thing, you have just to open National Geographic channel. Watch 5 to 6 National Geographic channel, how the environment has been destroyed by the men today. Now you are not responsible for that. But you can restore environment and you can do your fundamental duty enshrined in part 4A of the Constitution by planting one plant, by planting one tree, one small sapling today. Do it every year. Imagine 20 crore people, they are capable. 20 crore people putting a sapling in a vacant space available to them. And land is mass, huge land we have. We can do it. Imagine after 5 years, you have 100 crore plants. You will save environment, not for today, for the next generation. We have destroyed, my generation has destroyed it. You can restore it. And that is how you will be able to do one of your fundamental duties enshrined in part 4A of the Constitution. That is how we will be able to ensure a harmonious blend between the preamble to the Constitution, the fundamental rights and the fundamental duties. Of course, it will be great if someday the court has the courage, I am deliberately using the word courage, to say that directive principles of the state enshrined in part 4 of the Constitution are mandatory and the state is under an obligation to implement them. The state is under an obligation to provide food to them. All of us today, I feel ashamed that 454 million people go do not have a guaranteed meal twice a day. You have to read only this story from Odisha. Dr. Gupta will tell you the name of the village where till 1970 people used to eat grass. You have to go back to Rajasthan during Maharana Pratap when he was in exile. You have to read the story of a village near Jodhpur, Khejdi Kalan. You go to your net, you will find Wikipedia, Khejdi Kalan. The Sundarlal Bahuguna came in 1960s. That happened in 1736. Khejdi Kalan, where 363 men, women and children gave their life for protecting environment, for protecting Khejdi tree. Abhay Singh, the Maharaja of Jodhpur, wanted to construct a new palace. So he sent his minister for collecting wood, because that wood of that village Khejdi Kalan was considered to be very precious. An illiterate lady, modern illiterate lady, Amrita Devi, said that no, you will not, we will not allow you to cut the tree. And 363 people gave up their lives. Imagine that scenario, their concern about environment in 1736, and what we have done to the nature today. What we have done to the earth today. We are 100% not responsible. We are partly responsible. We must do our duty back to the society. Plant one sapling 1 year, maintain it. You will yourself feel so happy. When I was working in Andhra Pradesh, I had the opportunity to go to a place at a 52 kilometers from Hyderabad for inauguration of the new building, laying down foundation of the new building of the district court. So it was my practice, at least for 25 years I maintained it, that wherever I would go, my condition was that you must plant saplings. So there were about 50. So the district judge and my colleague judges, two of whom had accompanied me, they asked me, Chief, you do it. Then I go, no. I asked for the oldest person who was serving in that court. You come forward and plant this sapling. Because I knew I will not be able to take care of that sapling. But that man will feel proud and maintain the sapling. And when I asked the present CJ of Telangana, who happened to be my colleague in profession, he said, sir, all those have become big trees now. The amount of happiness which you will get by sapling a plant, I can't describe in words. My father, of course, I can feel proud. My father planted 3 lakh trees in Jodhpur city. And my youngest brother is following the same trade today. Thousands of saplings are planted. Perhaps Amar Vivek will be able to trace out that judgment of Punjab and Haryana High Court of 98 or 99, where in Haryana there were 5,000 saplings. In Chandigarh, sorry. And the administration, as usual, this bureaucracy and the filthy rich people decided that we should allot industrial plots of those 5,000. Luckily, Justice Amarjit Chaudhary granted his stay. Matter came before the bench after a period of 8 years. When we got inquiry conducted, then the chief conservator of forest of Punjab informed that now there are 55,000 trees there. And obviously the court could not have allowed them to convert them into plots. So friends, as Dr. Gupta had asked me to suggest solutions, these are few solutions which are not beyond our reach. We can fulfill our obligations under the Constitution, and apart from Constitution, as residents of this earth, as citizens of this state country. This is what I thought I would share, not only the duties enshrined in the preamble of the Constitution, but also duties which are inherent in yourself as good human beings. Thank you. Thank you, Vikas, and thank you, Amar Vivek, for giving me this opportunity to be with you.
Thank you. As I always say, Amar Vivek actually goes by his name, that whenever we join him or he allows anybody to come on the platform, the Vivek gets Amar, whatever way it is. So we have the questions and the chat box. I will read for you, sir, and Professor Gupta also.
Yes, yes, sure. Professor Gupta will definitely answer it.
So, I'm sure Justice Singhvi would do that.
So Komal Odichia, she has been a student of Professor Balram. Mm-hmm. Yes, I learned only on one of our sessions that she has been a student and now she's teaching in Jaipur.
Okay, fine.
I will unmute Komal ma'am for after some time. She asks, the present situation has ushered socialism and social values to the fore. Seeing plight of the migrant labor since last month, are we adhering to the aspects of the preamble, social justice?
Address to Komal ji, it is address to whom?
Sir, Justice Singhvi, I would say that, kindly.
Komal ji and all friends on the web, please delete the word migrant from your dictionary. They are our brothers and sisters. They are our children. It's an insult. It is just like an insult as we call people scheduled caste or scheduled tribe. Have you ever thought why they are called scheduled caste? For the purpose of giving benefit under the Constitution to socially downtrodden, we had in the Constitution put a schedule incorporating 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 120 as castes, similarly as tribes. But they are not any other anything else than the citizens of this country. And therefore, please do not call them migrant labor. Yes, somebody should have guts. The Supreme Court should have guts to say and direct the state to ensure that each one of them is provided meal, arrangements are made for their return back to their family.
We could spend in crores to evacuate people from abroad. But when it came to migrant laborers, I'm deleting that word migrant now forever for my this thing, mine. We could not do anything for these laborers. In fact, yesterday when I was watching some show, and a woman carrying 17-year-old child, then a laborer, wearing on one foot shoe and on the other just a chappal because of the injury he had and because of the constant walking for 5 days, So why couldn't we spend the same kind of, money on these laborers to make them, go back to their native places, because they just want to be with their families when the crisis is there.
Each one of us want to be with our families, and we have the luxury of being with our families, spending great time with them. And we are not able to afford to send them back. It is shame on the country that the gentleman minister comes on TV every day and says that we have arranged 64 flights from this place, that place, that place, that place. Why can't you put 1,000 buses? Why can't you put 1,000 trains for carrying these people, deprived people of their legitimate right to go back to their own native place? They want to die at their place. Why do you deprive them of that opportunity?
Yes, where is the welfare state?
Where is the welfare?
Yes.
Welfare did
very
not...
Very sad, in fact.
Komalji, mm-hmm. when the constitution was brought into force, at that time, 1950, our prime minister was guided by bureaucrats who, Dr. Rajendra Prasad had put them. Dr. Rajendra Prasad said in his speech on 15th of August 1947, that is available in B. Shivarao's fifth volume. You can read. That is in Hindi, lithograph print, all corrections carried out by Dr. Rajendra Prasad himself. In one of the paragraphs, he writes, there is another class who have so far served the Britishers, the foreigners. Now they must change their mindset and they should become servants of the people. This was the expression which that great man, one of the greatest human being on this free country, Dr. Rajendra Prasad, that said, now they should become servants of the people. Unfortunately, we never change the expression from public servant to servants of the people. And those public servant always taught that prime minister and today's prime minister also that everything is fine because we are able to support the industries, because we are able to support Vijay Mallya, we are able to support Nirav Modi. What can they do? These are all surrounded by sycophants. All have good intentions, but none, with great respect, none could be compared with the great prime minister called Lal Bahadur Shastri. He was a man from this earth. The rest have come from here.
I'm going to ask my students, every student, to have this duty to plant a sapling and contribute one fourth. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
It gives a pleasure that in fact large number of professors and all are from Jaipur. I will subsequently introduce Namita Jain. She's also there. Dhawan Ankit, the directive principles of the state policy contained in part 4th of the constitution set out the aims and objectives taken by the states in the governance. The ideas of welfare state envisaged by our constitution can only be achieved if states implement them with high sense and morality. But sir, why framers incorporated them as a reminders to the governments to achieve as welfare state, but also made them legally enforceable?
Because if you read properly Article 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, read, it's a job of the Supreme Court. They should have treated it as a mandate to the state. Merely writing that it is not enforceable in a court of law doesn't end the matter. Whenever you get opportunity to enforce, to hear a petition on fundamental rights, you first ask what the state has done. And state, don't confuse the state with the government. State includes judiciary. State is definition is inclusive. You must have seen Article 12 and Article 13 and interpretation of Article 12. It's inclusive. It shall include. So what is the hitch? And Supreme Court rightly in a number of judgments in 1990 said that directive principles are integral part of the preamble and part 3 of the constitution. State, that is why the framers of the constitution deliberately used the expression state shall. Why can't it be done? Article 142 gives that power to the Supreme Court. If they can rewrite the constitution by saying that the basic structure of the constitution can't be amended, can't be abridged, why can't they say tomorrow that directive principles of state policy are enforceable? When it comes to livelihood of the common man, yes, Vikas.
Yes, sir. So somehow the bandwidth, I'll just check it out. Meanwhile, I can read the question of sheet laws like article.
Not able to hear, Vikas.
While I was hearing you, the one fact, if you would recollect, and a large participants would recollect, it is said that when the, though it is not testified anywhere, when the there was plague in France, then the queen was asked that the people are not having the bread, what should they do? Then it was said that the queen answered that they should eat cake then. That was in the context that ones who were living in the higher hierarchy of the people, then they do not actually know the plight. Therefore, according to them, she thought that the if they cannot eat the bread, then at least the cake is much easier. So I can just take the questions. We are just running short of time. Virinder Singh, we cannot blame the framers of the constitutions for shortcoming in the governance in enforcing. That is his personal. I will ask Mr. Bimaldeep Singh. We are unmuting him. He's posing a lot of questions. He can ask himself. Mr. Bimaldeep Singh.
Sir, first of all, congratulations to the organizer. It was a mesmerizing session. It was just hypnotism flowing, and it was like Ganges was flowing downstream.
Thank you, Mr. Singh.
It was a package today. So my question is, sir, otherwise both of you have elaborated in a well-versed manner, and you have given a lot of sources also. But there is a pointed question what is your elaboration? It is for Gupta sir and you also. That what is your view regarding the constitution as a living document and dynamic tool in current context, particularly in relation to access to justice? And as somebody has just added to my input, that the constitution talks about judiciary, but it is ultimately the courts which are having the supremacy. Thank you, sir.
Yes, Dr. Gupta.
Please. Sir, constitution is a living document. In fact, my entire emphasis was that how we make it relevant and how we are able to achieve in the present context. Of course, justice is manifold for that matter, which needs to be taken care of. And in that particular process, the role of the judiciary is most significant, and some of the judgments recent do indicate that the role which the citizens have to play, the people have to play in regard to the duties which they have to discharge. Of course, what Justice Singhvi has all said about it is absolutely understandable and needs to be carried out. Coupled with that effort, if the people also come forward, certainly this particular document, a living document, and would be able to contribute and take care largely the various problems that we are encountering today. Thank you.
Mr. Singh, as far as my understanding goes, the people of this country have the power. None else, whether it is parliament, whether it is executive, whether it is judiciary. If you read the oath which all the judges take, they are nothing except they are doing their duty in accordance with the constitution. So it's a myth. It's a mistaken impression. It's a misgiving which the judges, if at all, they entertain that they possess some power. No, all their duties flow from the constitution. They have been enjoined with the duty to do justice. Of course, we can have a debate whether justice in our country is real or it's an illusion. Today, because unfortunately 99.99% people do not know what the constitution is. And you will be surprised. Many educated people do not know where the Supreme Court of India is.
So one question from a student of ULS. He's a quite bright student. Though it is
all
not to the
bright, president. All are bright, Vikas.
I stand corrected. It's a pleasure that we are being, after you were in the High Court, it's a pleasure that we have caught up on a virtual platform. But again, after it's just like an appearing before you. It's again a process wherein I'm learning and unchurning myself. That's the entire process.
This is exactly what I was saying, that we learn a lot always in his court.
I was Laksa myself a student always and continue to be so today.
Sir, what I have said earlier, a teacher also is throughout a student.
We are all.
Yes.
So I remember once meeting you in the High Court, outside the court in one of the functions, and I asked you, what is the key to success? And when do you feel that one will be over? You just gave a tip on one particular day. You said that the day you think that you know everything and you stop learning, you should feel that your end has come for the knowledge part. I still try to imbibe those facts which you have told on that particular day.
Dear friends, our life is just like a ladder, which has no end. So you can just go on climbing. Once you start thinking that I have reached the top, then you have no option but to come down. So think that you are catching up each step in the ladder, which is unending, ends with your life.
Sir,
till then you are a student.
Sir, thank you, sir. It's just reminded, though off the cuff, there was a movie, Naam, in which Sanjay Dutt said that it's a one-way traffic. If you start trying to reverse, it's a one-way road, and if you turn, there will be end to it. The same way the letter you said. So Akshit Pathani asks, I wanted to ask your views on LGBTQ, especially in the backdrop of the judgment of Suresh Kumar Kaushal that criminalized homosexuality. What is your take on that? Though it's off this thing, but I still couldn't resist it.
You have another webinar on that topic, because one line answer will not satisfy anybody.
So point well taken. I happily acknowledge the fact that you have acceded to that you will come on a second session. That fact was always there. I thought that after the session I would again request you.
I owe a large part of my existence to the fraternity at Chandigarh.
So we are all it's always an enriching session. Once inside the court, your judgments and hearing you itself has increased that knowledge platform. I will ask Mr. Amar Vaik. He had one question to you. Mr. Amar Vaik, I'm just unmuting him. He's again, as my lords are well aware, and Dr. Balram Gupta. I would always say, because he's an elder brother to me, he's been a wonderful energy source. He gives you what to go about it. He tells you how to move forward in life. Over to Mr. Amar Vaik.
Good afternoon, sir. In fact, after listening to such an illuminating conversation, I would say, it is not one question. We are flooded with questions which we must answer ourselves. But one thing, sir, I would like to say, that in Punjab and Haryana High Court, your lordships had been pleased to render a judgment on the rights of ready vendors, that they were to squat at a place. Whereas earlier view of the administration was that ready is something moving. But if everybody would start moving some 5,000 people, then how the Chandigarh roads would be able to sustain them? So sir, this was that today we have an act. But that act is also, I would say, in a way denying their rights. it is not that when we are creating the vending zones, we are trying to restrict them to a place. Basically, my question is, today I as the citizen, so-called enlightened citizen, cannot sustain myself without the vendors. Is it not my duty that I look after those vendors? They are serving me.
Absolutely right, Amar Vivek. I would only add one thing. We should ask a question to ourselves. Why people have to vend already? Why have we not in 70 years been able to create a situation where everybody is engaged in some work with the dignity? You have to hear one poem from one story from Arun Jaimini of Haryana. He is a poet. I have been listening to him for quite some time. In fact, I had a live session with him long ago while in Chandigarh. In one of his poem, he talks about the purchase of 1 kg apple. He said that if 50 rupees is the price of 1 kg, then what is the price of 100 grams? And you just hear, because my narration will not help it. You just hear him. Why we have that idea of ready people? Why we should have idea of people? When I go for a walk in the morning, these days I can't go. When I go in the morning in Delhi, Delhi is of course a different place than Chandigarh. I see people sleeping on the footpath. Whether it is sun, whether it is winter, whether it is summer, I feel ashamed. Why should my brethren not have a place to live? And when deciding the case of 2 lakh people from Haryana in Faridabad, I remember the Advocate General said that we can't afford. Then the court had to make a curt observation. Well, the government should resign if they can't afford. If the governments can't provide meal to the citizens, if the government can't provide shelter, they have no right to be there. They are all servants of people. That is the duty which we owe now, to imbibe in their mind that you are servants of people, you are not our master. Unfortunately, whether it is 1975 or whether it is 2020, we are still considered as second-rate citizens in our country. The first-raters are those who cheat, who commit robbery on the common man.
There were a large number of questions pouring in, but as a practice, we don't go beyond 1.5 hours, but still we have just reached that. But before we go that, we have a slight module on this platform. We always ask, since we call legal luminaries, former judges and judges from the Supreme Court, we feel that if at least we could come to know how one could make a mark within the society, not as a professional, but as a human being. As we say, first, it is important to be a good human, rather than just simplicity being human being. So what is your take? What a one person should do as a professional, as a human being, to make a mark within the society, how he can contribute in a little bit, except the point well taken that each one of us has to plant one sapling. As we say, each one teach one and each one plant one. Over to you, sir. Just to say.
Vikas, and to all other friends, if you have to make a mark yourself, then you must learn to yourself. You must understand what you are. The first thing which each one of us as a professional has to do is to do his duty honestly and sincerely. I was given oath as a judge on 20th of July 1990. My father was a lawyer. His contemporary as a lawyer became a judge and then retired. So after oath ceremony was over when I came back to my place at Jodhpur, because we were to travel back to Jaipur. My father told, you go and meet Justice Kan Singh Pariyar, a former judge of the High Court. I went to him and for blessings, and then I asked him, sir, some tips how to work as a judge. Because lawyers initially are bad judges. So he said, no, no, you will learn with the passage of time, you will learn everything. Still, I insisted that please tell, give me some tips. Then he said, and that is good for the lawyers also. He said, you must hear the lawyer. Because lawyer does not represent his cause. He represents somebody else's cause who has been paid. Second thing he said, never leave two things from yourself. They are your integrity and morality. And Vikas and dear friends, all of us must remember one thing. That is for not only for lawyers, not for law students, not for judges, but for every human being. Each one of us must learn one thing. We should always be honest to ourselves. If you commit something wrong on a particular day, perhaps entire world would never know. Your wife would never know. Your children would not know. Your parents may not know. But one person will always know. And that person is your soul. You can always test check it. If you have committed something wrong on a particular day, when you go to your bed, your soul will come out. Soul always comes out in the night and tells you that you have done something wrong. So you can't run away. And for this also, I will request you to hear one song from film Kajal. This was by Rajkumar and Meena Kumari. Tora man darpan kehlaye, bhale bure sare karmo ko dekhe aur dikhaye. Those poets are actually great. All these poets are great human beings. They teach you basic fundamental values of life. Not lawyers, we are not at all important, but they are.
So, point well taken. As we all say, the heart is on the left, but it always thinks right.
Vikas, can I also add one?
Definitely. I cannot. I just remember Guru Gobind Dau Khade Kaake Lagu Paaye. Balihari Guru Aapki.
Quite right. Absolutely. That is why.
Professor Balram Gupta has been our teacher, so we have to rever him like anything.
Okay. You know, once Harold Laski wrote a letter to Justice Holmes, saying how much I wish if the people could understand and realize that judges are human beings. Justice Holmes wrote back to Harold Laski, how much I wish if judges could realize that they are human beings. We all are human beings. And we need to realize that this realization ultimately is the basic barometer of success in life. Thank you.
And one request to all my colleague judges also, former as well as future.
Yes.
India is a unique country in the world, which has no parallel. 109 yes. recognized languages are spoken.
Yes.
More than 20,000 dishes are prepared in India every day. 20,000. No country in the world has yes. such a variety of human beings. America in itself is a great country. Russia in itself is a great country.
Yes.
Britain in itself is a great country. Justice Marshall was great in his own way.
Yes.
Natsky was great in his own way. Lord Denning was great in his own way. But while interpreting our constitution, what unfortunately the Supreme Court of the past committed a mistake, that they drew inspiration from Lord Denning, like as if he was demigod. I am not denying that he is a great judge. But for this country where 90% population at that time is not literate, not literate, they do not know ABC of the Constitution of India. Let us not import everything from abroad. Modern days, these days we talk, every one of us start talking about Singapore. How can we compare Singapore, a small population of 50 lakhs plus, what that country has a comparison, not in my one city. So stop. Let us talk of our constitution for our people, interpret it. Give an interpretation which suits the people of this country at a given point of time. That is the dynamics of Indian constitution.
That's right.
So thank you. Lokesh Singhal has posed a very long question, but the pith and substance of the question would be...
Where is Lokesh?
Lokesh Singhal. So he has posed one question. Because some sessions of the AG office also, they are also on webinars.
Okay.
Lokesh is there? Just check it out. Sir, Lokesh says, he's reminded of that quote, "Do not ask what the country does for you, but tell what you are doing for the country." His pith and substance of that entire question is this. I'm just unmuting Lokesh for a minute, because Lokesh is again a backbone of Beyond Law CLC, has been given inputs. Lokesh, over to you.
Namaskar, sir.
Lokesh Singhal.
Namaskar. Kaise hai Lokesh ji? Great to see you.
Sir, thank you.
Thank you.
Sir, I just wanted to say that
Lokesh, nearer to the mic, please. Lokesh, near to the mic.
Sir, we keep on holding seminars, webinars on fundamental rights. Sir, we don't talk about fundamental duties. Sir, I just, Palkiwala, my lord, has dedicated his book, that we the people, to the countrymen. He says, who gave unto themselves the constitution but not the ability to keep it, who inherited a resplendent heritage but not the wisdom to cherish it, who suffer and endure in patience without the perception of their potential. Now, sir, we don't talk about this. We don't hold seminars on fundamental duties, what we are supposed to do for the country, for the society. And we keep on holding seminars for the fundamental rights, fighting for fundamental rights, justice. Sir, that's my question. Why don't we talk about the fundamental duties also?
Perhaps you were not there in the earlier part of the session.
Please, sir.
I had requested you in it's only repetition. You take out YouTube, type film Ankush. And the Prarthana in Ankush.
I remember.
Itni shakti hame dena data.
Man ka vishwas kamjor hona.
You will get answer.
That's right.
Mm. You will get answer in the last two lines. Nani Palkiwala's book substance is those two lines. We should not think that what the society has given to us. We should think what we have given to the society. Each one of us. Those who are on this, because computers are not for the people who are workers, who are forced to come from Jharkhand to Karnataka. They don't have computer. We have got. We are all able, financially able. We should think about others. That what can we give back to the society? Because everything, it's something which... The hardest truth, and the most universally accepted truth, which Napoleon also, we quote him usually after death. He said that I had come empty-handed. All of us come empty-handed. Unless some science evolves something which can guarantee that a person after his death will carry something with him in the other world, we all are going to leave everything here. So it all belongs to this material world. Let us remember that every day in the morning we should remember we have come empty-handed. We will leave empty-handed. So give it back to the society.
Sir, we have been blessed to hear you. Few takes of yours in Hindi would just give a different facet to this while we are ending to the webinar.
Pardon?
Sir, kuch Hindi mein bhi bol dein, jo aapko Hindi mein bhi sunne ka maza hai, kuch alag hi hai. Aap vakilon ko kya kehna chahenge aur baaki logon ko kya kehna chahenge?
वो आप LIC की एक मैगजीन ले लीजिएगा, बहुत पुरानी है, चंडीगढ़ से छपी थी. मैं गया था डॉक्टर बलराम गुप्ता को, शायद याद होगा.
मेरे को याद है, बिल्कुल याद है.
आप लक्ष साहब को याद है कि मैं चंडीगढ़ में नेक्स्ट अपने लॉ स्कूल में ही गया था, लॉ यूनिवर्सिटी में, लॉ फैकल्टी में, सॉरी. 200-250 स्टूडेंट थे उस दिन. तो मैंने मेरा उद्बोधन हिंदी में प्रारंभ किया था और आधा हिंदी में करने के बाद में इंग्लिश में बोलना पड़ा. आज आपने जैसा कहा है, तो मैं कुछ महीने के बाद में मैं एक जलंधर जा रहा था, किसी डॉक्टर गुरुदेव सिंह थे उस समय, तो उन्होंने बुलाया था. तो वो एक मैगजीन मेरे घर पे आई थी, तो मैंने कहा चलो साथ लेके गाड़ी में बैठे पढ़ देंगे. जब मैगजीन थोड़ी देर बाद में खोली तो उसकी टाइटल पर मेरा नाम एक लेख में लिखा हुआ था. मुझे बड़ी क्यूरियोसिटी हुई कि ये जो LIC की मैगजीन, उसमें मेरा नाम क्या करना. तो उसमें जब लेख में देखा तो उसने बड़े ईमानदारी से उस जिस लेखक थे उन्होंने लिखा कि मैं भी स्टूडेंट था, स्टूडेंट हूँ लॉ यूनिवर्सिटी में. मैं जब वो जस्टिस सिंह भी वहां पर बोलने आए तो उन्होंने हिंदी में अपना भाषण दिया. वो जब करीब 45 मिनट हिंदी में बोल लिए, फिर तो मैंने ये सोचा कि शायद इनकी अंग्रेजी कमजोर है इसलिए ये हिंदी में बोल रहे हैं. तो ये बात सही है, मेरी इंग्लिश भी कमजोर है और मेरी हिंदी भी कमजोर है. मैं सिर्फ आपसे कम्युनिकेट कर सकता हूँ.
सवाल ये है कि अगर आपकी हिंदी और इंग्लिश कमजोर है तो मैं यही कहता हूँ कि अगर सबकी हिंदी और इंग्लिश आपकी जितनी कमजोर हो जाए तो देश का बड़ा उद्धार हो जाएगा. और जाने से पहले सर, बिफोर वी कॉल अपॉन डॉक्टर नमिता जैन, शी इज फ्रॉम जयपुर एंड शी इज द हेड ऑफ द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ द लॉ कॉलेज. आई एम जस्ट रिमाइंडेड ऑफ द फेमस सॉन्ग्स. फ्यू वन कपलेट आई विल रीड फॉर यू. आज जाने की जिद ना करो, यूं ही पहलू में बैठा रहो. हाय मर जाएंगे हम तो लुट जाएंगे, ऐसी बातें मत किया करो. टुडे वी आर नॉट एग्रीइंग दैट यू शुड पार्ट, बट वी विल अगेन मीट. ओवर टू डॉक्टर नमिता जैन एंड दोज़ हू वांट टू एंड दोज़ हू वांट टू स्टे कनेक्टेड विद अस. टुमारो वी हैव अ वेबिनार ऑन फ्रीडम ऑफ एक्सप्रेशन, दे कैन जॉइन टुमारो. ओवर टू डॉक्टर नमिता जैन, शी इज फ्रॉम जयपुर ओनली सर.
गुड आफ्टरनून ऑल. आई डीम इट अ ग्रेट ऑनर एंड प्रिविलेज टू प्रपोज द वोट ऑफ थैंक्स. First and foremost, I thank Justice G.S. Singhvi, former judge, Supreme Court of India, who found time to grace the webinar. I also express my heartfelt thanks to Dr. Balramji Gupta for his senior advocate and director academics, Chandigarh Judicial Academy, for his valuable contribution. Thank you, sir, for a wonderful thought and provoking session. I also thank to all the participants, whether they are academicians or advocates or students, for attending this webinar. Once finally, I leave you this inspiring quote by Martin Luther King: "An individual has not started living until he rises above the confines of his individualistic concern to the broader concerns of all humanities." Once again, I thank you, all of you. Thank you.
बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद आपको.
जस्टिस सिंह भी एंड में जाने से पहले एक बार फिर यही कि आप पे कोई नए टॉपिक के साथ. पर कल के लिए हमारा टॉपिक है फ्रीडम ऑफ एक्सप्रेशन, गुड टाइम्स बैड टाइम्स बाय वेंकट जी एट 11:30.
Thank you so much, Justice Singhvi. It has been a delight. Absolutely. Look forward to have a session with you.
Thank you so much.
Sir, Professor Balram Gupta, who is part of Pura Beyond Law, hai, Beyond Law CLC, unki daughter Shruti Bedi, they are all part of it. Thank you for encouraging us. They are acting as a guide, the guru for all this endeavors. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Vikas. Thank you so much, Vikas. Kind of you.
Sure.